I'm sorry, there's nothing we can do. I'm going to have to hire someone else for cheaper.
Yeah, what's that meme of the, like, at my funeral, my boss crying at my funeral. How could you do this today? We're so understaffed.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Well, you know who else is understaffed?
The Spectator Film Podcast?
Yes, it is.
We really need a fucking editor or something.
Yeah, please. We need an editor and we need some joke writers. Please send in your applications. We can't afford to pay you.
I will pay you in my delightful puns and Reprolodogenic Opera.
Well, they wouldn't knowledge. Be your puns. The knowledge would be yours alone, but...
Well, I'm saying I'll give you a couple of jokes for free in exchange for you giving us a couple of jokes for free.
As you can see, the situation is dire.
Very dire.
My name is Austin.
I am Max.
And today, what movie are we talking about, Max?
The Devil Rides Out!
That's a proper introduction. Neither of us have shouted yet.
Yeah.
This is a movie worth yelling about, in my opinion.
No, it's very exciting. Austin pitched this to me as, I believe, his favorite Hammer film?
No.
No?
Okay. No.
I'm wrong already.
No. I mean, Dracula, for sure.
But it was one of his favorites, and he was astonished, ashamed, and delighted that I hadn't seen it all at once, kind of.
I would say that it's in the top group for me. I would say it's lesser than a number of other Hammer movies for me, especially after watching it this time. But I was very surprised you hadn't seen this movie because it, despite that, it's like a great Christopher Lee performance. There's lots of punching. There's lots of yelling. There's lots of intense scaring. Yeah, there's hypnotizing with his magnetic. He talks about wine.
Yes.
He even talks about wine, everyone. So if you want that from your Christopher Lee performance, this is a good movie. I would double this with the Gorgon, and you just get like a straight shot of like Christopher Lee right into your heart.
And also,
perfect.
This movie hit me perfectly because it finally got through. Because nowadays, and for most like satanic cult movies,
yeah,
you can't have a demon show up because it's you have to maintain the air of mystery around the cult of like, what are they doing? What, like, is it actually going to work, or is these just insane people? Or like, you want to maintain some like mystery,
the ambiguity.
Yeah, it's great that way. No, I don't want that. If you have a fucking devil worshipping cult in your movie, I want them to summon a devil. Like, I want there to be a demon.
Yes, we have seen the movie where they play with a Valutin version of this, where it's that question of the fantastic that we talk about all the time. And we'll return to it in the commentary track for this, for sure. It's an interesting subject with this movie. But they just dive right into it. You know that these people are fucking Satan worshipers. And God damn it, you have to fucking smack them across the face. If you're Christopher Lee, you've just got to.
I'm not saying there's not a place for, like, the ambiguous... Yeah. Mysterious type of devil worshipping movie. I'm saying it's been done to death.
Yes.
And it is like, it's like drinking a fine wine then just going back to drinking like water or something.
Yes.
Of, oh, right, this is refreshing. Okay, cool. It's just, they're literally summoning the devil.
And by the way, just to add on to what you're saying in another topic, just a little sneak preview for everyone that we will definitely be talking about during the commentary track. What other movie came out during the same exact year, 1968, that if this movie, The Devil Rides Out, had tried to be ambiguous, we would constantly be comparing it to even more than we are already? Rosemary's Baby.
Yes.
And you know what this movie could not do, even if it did that, is approach the level of competence and artistry in Rosemary's Baby. So you know what? Better to just not even compete with that.
Yeah, but you know what? Fucking nobody in Rosemary's Baby like throws a crucifix and explodes the devil. So like,
yes, that's true.
It's very ambiguous. It's is the better movie?
It's a different type of approach on similar material, and it's a very fun thing to contrast them because there's a number of similarities nonetheless. But yeah, I would say this is not one of my favorite Hammer movies, although it's in the like my group of favorites. I just think it's a great Christopher Lee performance. I think there's a lot of fun set pieces in this movie, more so than a number of other Hammer movies, where usually their set pieces, when I think of those movies, I think of mostly like Frankenstein stuff, because that forces you to have set pieces with his experiments. Whereas in their other horror movies, it's more about atmosphere and performance and things like that. In this one, you got tons of action set pieces. They don't always pull them off perfectly.
No, not at all.
Sometimes it's a little clumsy, but that's okay. It's still charming. I think it adds to the virtue of the movie.
That's what I'm saying. Well,
yeah.
And it's slightly more realistic because, like, yeah, it's said briefly that Christopher Lee and man that is around him a lot.
Rex.
They were in the war together.
Close your eyes, Rex.
Along with the other character's father.
Yeah.
But, like, they're not like...
We'll save that for the...
They're not action heroes, but I'm saying the clumsiness kind of makes it a little bit more believable.
Sure.
It allows you to get drawn into the world, and it's not just filmmaking mistakes.
So, yeah, I mean, it's an occult movie. I think it's a movie more so than Hammer's other films that we've covered on the show. This movie, I think, has very memorable scenes and has scenes that, like, hit it out of the park. And then there's other scenes that are not as good.
I like this movie. I really do. It's definitely, I would probably say, in my top five for Hammer now.
Sure.
But this movie has three endings, which is baffling.
We will
me.
Get to that.
Yeah.
That's like, actually something a lot of people have picked up on.
The pacing of this movie is bizarre and like...
has some weird transitions.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the movie feels like it could conclude three separate times and it only does it on one of those. And after the second time, you're like, do we really need to keep going with this?
Do they have to return to the Shire?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I understand what you're saying, but I still think it's just a sort of fun, rollicking adventure. I'd say this is a good sort of counter-programming type movie to do with other sorts of horror movies from around this period, where this film feels a little bit quaint when it is just released. But I think it's just an overall fun movie. But so you've already started to talk about like your experience with this movie. You haven't seen it before this week, but
no,
like. I'm curious, like, before we really, like, jump into the movie, like, specifically how you might rank this or even what your ranking is.
Well, that's the thing. Like, it's for granted that Dracula is the best movie Hammer ever produced, right? Like,
I think that's a pretty uniform opinion.
Yeah, like, I hate saying it, but, like, it's true.
I don't. There's something about that movie they did slightly differently. And they were very bold, and they made some surreal choices in it with full confidence that I feel like they don't get in as many other movies.
And some of the sequels, even though they're not as good, I like a lot of the Dracula sequels.
Yeah.
And Peter Cushing as Frankenstein is also very well. And also, you showed me The Gorgon for the first time, which is now in my top three favorite Hammer films.
The Gorgon's great.
I really love The Gorgon. Some of those movies do have pacing problems, but this one it keeps giving me whiplash to the point that it's like more noticeable than some of the other Hammer films.
Like I said, great scenes, but overall it's sort of like stop and start as a movie.
It's a very silly, spooky, devil worshipping movie that, like a lot of Hammer films, is absolutely perfect for a Halloween party.
Yeah. And that's a good thing to point out what you're saying. It's like, it has an adventurer attitude. An adventurous attitude, more so than other occult movies.
100%.
Especially comparing it to stuff like Rosemary's Baby. Obviously, Rosemary's
the
more
effective
movie. We're
going to be talking a lot about Rosemary's Baby.
But it's good because 1968 is just such an interesting year, politically, culturally, for movies and everything.
Satanically.
Really. Yeah. So the fact that these two movies came out, you know, within the same 12 months is pretty remarkable and interesting. It shows like the different directions that... different strains of horror we're going in. But I just think, you know, this movie is a really fun addition to anyone who's interested in Hammer. And anyone who's interested in sort of light, fun horror movies that still sort of offer some really intriguing, creepy mood and scenes that sort of have these fun set pieces that still work in a way that is like a Halloween aesthetic.
Yeah, I would 100%.
It's almost like a Halloween James Bond.
That's a good way of putting it.
Yeah.
Although there's... slightly less rape in this movie than a James Bond movie. Only slightly, but less.
That we see.
True.
And I don't know why I made that point. Oh, great. I'm just going to be thinking about that the whole time. That's awesome.
Well, hey, at least Christopher Lee does not rape anybody in this movie. So he's more heroic than James Bond has ever been.
And does he rape anyone in James Bond either? I think he's more heroic in that movie probably than James Bond is. Scaramanga.
So basically the conclusion we came from watching The Devil's Right Out is fuck James Bond.
Get him out of here. We're going to send our Satanist Christopher Lee after him. But yeah,
that's another point I'll get into in the movie, but like you can't just very briefly, like you can't have Christopher Lee as your protagonist and then make the charismatic leader of your cult just not anywhere close to him. Like,
yeah, they had to give him better scenes.
They had to give... maybe it's just the actor, though. Like, I'm not sure what
Let's
else
Let's talk
he's
about
been
it in the commentary.
Yeah.
I have some fun news for you. You do know what else he's been in.
Okay.
I am shocked you don't remember this, but it's going to be fun to hear your response. But yeah, I aside from that, I think maybe I would point people who maybe this is the first time you've listened to our show. God help you.
Sorry about that.
Yeah. This is usually what it's like, I'm sorry to say. But I would point you in the direction of a ton of Hammer movies that we did last year for Halloween. And we talk a lot about like Terrence Fisher's pet themes and motifs that he tends to use, the way that these movies tend to have a more sort of conservative and reactionary standpoint in terms of their monsters and how they other them, pathologizing of desire and sex, all that good stuff. We talk about it quite a bit in those movies. And this movie is certainly no different. In fact, I'd say it's one of the more reactionary movies from Terrence
100%.
Fisher. Yeah. So I would say that if you're interested in this movie, those other commentary tracks, those other episodes might be fun to do as well. Of course, we did Dracula, we did the Gorgon, we did two Frankensteins.
Yes.
And then
I think we did another Dracula movie as well.
No. Two Frankensteins. We did Curse the Werewolf. Regal fanfare music.
Ah, gotta love subtitles.
Yeah. That good old Regal fanfare. That
from everybody's favorite studio, Regal fanfare.
20th Century Fox. Wow, look at that. When do you want to start talking about real things? Let's talk about these titles. These titles are fun.
They are. We got the goat. I have my matching shirt of Be My Beelzebub, one of my favorite shirts to wear.
Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah.
Figured it fit the appropriate programming.
Oh, we should also mention before we get too far, we are watching the Shout Factory Blu-ray, which was a great release that they put out last year in 2019. So that's the version we're watching. And the reason I brought that up is because I saw the title. It appears not only just because of the 20th Century Fox, which I assume handled distribution in the U.S., but it would seem that the title in the U.S. for this movie was The Devil's Bride. I think a far worse title.
To be fair, The Devil Rides Out almost sounds like a Western film. But like,
I think people did think it was a Western in the U.S., actually. Like, people doing the marketing and stuff, I think I was reading that they actually did think it was one.
Okay, so
they were
the
confused.
Only one.
Yeah. But The Devil Ride, that sounds badass.
It does.
You know? And as we can see here, this is directed by Terrence Fisher, and it has all his collaborators that we've seen work so well on those other Hammer movies. We had James Bernard doing the wonderful musical score, and then we have Bernard Robinson doing the amazing sets again, and the script was written by Richard Matheson, of all people, author of I Am Legend, most famously.
Yes, my favorite film, I Am Legend.
That movie, the Will Smith one, you mean?
Yeah.
That one is great, I think, until the last act. Then it just becomes awful.
I'm going to dish out some controversial opinions here.
Yeah?
I have never seen a movie starring Will Smith that I enjoyed him in. I do not think he's that interesting of an actor. I'd find him boring in almost every
film. That is a hot take. That's interesting. But yeah, we have the wonderful entrance, I think, for such a boring character. Does he really deserve this entrance, Rex?
No.
Arriving in his fucking airplane?
Rex becomes redundant in the second half of the movie, and it's not like he was that interesting in the first
half either. No, he really isn't. Christopher Lee carries this movie, but I think the more you watch it, the more you realize how much of a vacuum there is in the other characters around him.
Give some of Christopher Lee's personality traits or like abilities to other characters, please. Like, I love him in this because, like, listen, if you want to make any character a Mary Sue, make it Christopher Lee.
Yeah, but can't you at least have Christopher Lee as a badass convince us that this other guy is cool by saying some of the cool things he did, supposedly?
Also, it doesn't... The first time I was watching this, I'm just like, oh, so Christopher Lee is a Satanist because he's, like, dressed like Mephistopheles.
Yes,
like,
he's got the goatee and everything. But I do like that outfit choice because there's a type of ambiguity that makes him badass, you know?
I love that.
Oh, the horn he has to tell his driver where to go. In his apparently, that was a
Rolls
Royce.
The same air as the poor.
Yes. Well, this movie upholds a lot of the same aristocratic attitudes that we see in a lot of the other Hammer movies and Terrence Fisher movies specifically. But I just think that opening sequence is a great job in establishing the setting and also the mood, kind of. Because one thing we're going to be talking about throughout this movie is something that I mentioned in the introduction, which is how this movie uses a lot of set pieces that we associate with more sort of adventure type stories, and how this movie...
I'm sorry. What? I love how he hands his cane and hat to the butler, and the butler just puts,
down to the table. Yes.
Immediately.
Yeah, it's great. So yes, they're arriving here at the party. And I think this is another instance of what I was just about to say, which is utilizing a type of adventure trope. So when this movie was produced, Max, I think Hammer got the rights to this and several other Dennis Wheatley books in the early 60s, only they did not feel they could really produce it with the censors being the way they were in the UK at the time. By 1968, I think they finally felt comfortable enough to try to go ahead and make this one, albeit some of the like censorable material is pretty quaint when you really look at it. But still, they did their best, their British best. So originally, though, Max, they had intended to make this a series with the Duke de Richelieu, this character, and potentially these other ones as well. But really, it's Christopher Lee, right? And Christopher Lee was fully on board with that. And I think he originally came to them with the book to begin with because he had really liked it. So I think it's sort of a lost opportunity. It was going to be a series. But again, I think that speaks to this, how the source material and this movie are sort of, they're a hybrid between like horror and like adventure. You know, they're sort of like serialized in that way. And I think that's also, while we will definitely compare this a lot to Rosemary's Baby, you can also compare it a lot to, I think, James Bond. Particularly this scene. Why? We've just met our big villain in a very lame way, if you ask me, but we'll get back to that later.
The big main villain is very lame, in my opinion, but it's okay.
He has some good moments. Charles Gray, who, by the way, was the narrator of Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Oh, okay. That makes sense.
Do you want to know how old he was?
80,000.
In this movie?
45.
Lower.
40?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
I think he was 40, yeah.
Sucks to get some genes, people. It really does. I'm sorry about that.
I think he's younger than Christopher Lee.
Oh, my God. I saw there was a nice photo that was floating around the internet of Christopher Lee and Ian McKellen. I think it was on the set of The Hobbit. They were just driving around on a golf cart. And I'm just like, at least Christopher Lee got to spend the last couple of years of his life doing what he loved and adapting Tolkien's work.
I like to think he did a lot of his life doing what he loved.
No, I'm saying, but like, he especially got to do that. He loved Tolkien's stuff.
So. Yeah. Yeah. He was a huge nerd. Yep. Sometimes, for me at least, he would be an irritating nerd, but also he's just like a special person. It's like, I think you might deserve to be the person who gets to do this.
To write incandescent, like incessant letters to Tolkien asking him about different things in Elvish, and Tolkien just being like,
oh, I don't know. Go write about it in Wikipedia, you fucking nerd. Yeah. My favorite Christopher Lee story is maybe the one where he got in an argument with the producers of The Wicker Man. Do you know this? Where he formed a grudge against them, I think, because they wouldn't stand up when his wife entered the room. I fucking love that. I think you can, like, read his memoirs. Like, I knew they were stupid boors the moment they didn't fucking stand up when my wife walked in. But anyway.
Good for him.
We're on a tangent.
That's not a bad thing.
Here's where he's talking about the fucking wine, yeah. As I mentioned to you earlier, Dennis Wheatley, before he wrote books, he was a wine seller. So it seems that in a lot of his novels, they actually have tons of scenes where they just randomly stop and pause the narrative to talk about wine, which actually, depending on the circumstances, kind of sounds a little bit like fun to me. But the point I was going to finish making earlier about this sort of parlor room espionage that they're doing, sneaking into this party, it reminds me of James Bond in the way where you are introduced usually to James Bond villains in some sort of formal or party setting before James Bond explicitly confronts them, you know? Like, you think of, like, what?
I just love, like, the idea that you're going to this person's house and, like, you're conducting yourself with proper manners. Christopher Lee's like, I see you have a telescope.
I'm going upstairs. He's very passive-aggressive. I'm going to say this movie has moments like that, Max, where it approaches the campiness of the Gorgon, even if I don't think it ever really reaches the same heights.
Oh, it's campier than the Gorgon, in my opinion.
In some ways it is. But Christopher Lee in this is not as, like, up his own ass. Actually, I don't know if that's true. he is up his own ass even more so than in this one, because there's no material consequences for anything, which is something we'll talk about. But like, this movie takes place entirely within the insular bubble of this aristocratic society. And as far as I'm concerned, there's almost no difference between the, say, like, what are they going to do? What happens if they succeed? Who cares? To the, like, help or whatever throughout the buildings, it's all just the same shit anyway. Christopher Lee talks to his butler about all this stuff, and he's like, well, another day at this house. No one cares. So it makes no difference for anyone who wins.
It's not like, yeah, they're trying to open a gateway to hell to destroy everything. It's like, they're risking the lives of so many people throughout this movie to stop this one dude and later a woman from joining a cult that all seem to be having a very good time, honestly.
Yeah.
They don't do anything wrong.
Yeah. It's pure anxiety over them being different than me. But yeah, so I think an interesting point of comparison are some of those adventure story type motifs that you see repeated in stuff like James Bond versus this. Obviously, in James Bond, you will be introduced to the villain in a party setting or a formal setting before James Bond actually has to like fist fight them or something. You think of like Casino Royale, right? They go play poker against them before they know they actually are fighting each other, you know? But also, I just think the opening shot, Max, the idea of this, you know, handsome man arriving on an airplane in the 20s, that's such an adventure movie cliche, isn't it? That's like a joke. That's what the assholes do, the rich assholes do in romantic comedies before the girl is about to make the terrible mistake of marrying them. They arrive on an airplane. That's how you know it's fucked up. So we're going to see a lot of that throughout this movie. And I think even though it's a little bit awkward, that's what makes this movie a little bit more lively at different times to me than some of the other ones. My only regret, Max, is that I really do wish they had Christopher Lee doing more of it. You know? Because I'll be honest, Rex does some cool things, but I think his character is just kind of nothing.
Well, he only does those things when directed by Christopher Lee to do said things.
Yeah, and Christopher Lee has to go on like errands to like pick up milk or something.
That's like, that's the only time Rex has chance to do things, when it's like Christopher Lee being like, I have to go to the library now to look at a book. Rex, I'm totally you do not, everything else.
Oh, he just punched him out.
Yep, as you do.
Should we continue this conversation after Christopher Lee just punches the shit out of the rest of these people? Oh, is that a butler I hear? Time to fucking roll up my sleeves.
No, you don't even need to pull up the sleeves. You got that signet ring for added points.
Yeah, Christopher Lee basically does the thing where he smacks the woman and knocks her out because she's being hysterical, so he can then abduct her and because he knows what's best for her. Only it turns out in this movie, the woman is not a woman, it's Simon. And they just casually arrive there. And again, Max, what does the butler say in response to this? Oh, I'll get you the tray. I'll get you the brandy.
And what is the butler's name?
Bill.
No. It's a very great name. Possibly the best name.
Oh, God, I don't know.
It's Max.
Oh, Max. Right, okay.
Oh, right. You punched me out for being a Satanist.
Now I'm going to hypnotize you.
How dare you believe in anything but Christianity? This is the thing, though. It's not like they use crosses and whatnot later, but like he's using a kind of mysticism as well.
Yeah, they throw lip service into him being sort of more Christian, where there's a bit at the end where he's like, and do you say you're like a big fan of Jesus? And the woman is like, okay. And he's like, that's great.
Cool.
But I feel like I agree with you. And I think that's something from the source material too, where it was less explicitly Christian, but a mixture of like Judeo-Christian stuff with like Indo-Aryan.
Well, that's the thing though. Like, I mean, the version of Satan that we explicitly see in this movie is Baphomet, which is not even Satan. It's
the goat of Mendes.
Yes. Goat of Mendes, which is another name for Baphomet.
I would make that joke to Sam Mendes, director of whatever the fuck that war movie was from last year. What was that called? Sam Mendes?
That was just like a dildo hanging out on the night side table up there. Got your cross, your Bible, and your dildo.
The cock rides out.
The jokes keep coming, but...
Or is that what it means when the devil rides out?
Anyway.
Devil rides with the cock out. Let's just move on.
We were talking about that there's like two different kinds of magic in this, or is there's right-hand path and left-hand path?
Yes.
Magic and the right-hand path magic. Sort of retroactively, people are like, oh, well, Judeo-Christian stuff falls under that because that's the good one. And then the left-hand path is like evil demon worship.
It's Mr. Crowley.
Yeah.
Mr. Crowley.
How is Ozzy Osbourne still alive? Maybe he didn't.
Fuck you. Knock on some wood right now. Okay, that's enough. Don't bring it up again.
I was only thinking of it because I saw a meme the other day that was literally just like Ozzy Osbourne getting to heaven and seeing all the musicians who OD'd and like, it smells like bitch in here.
Not everyone can have Sharon to save them.
True.
Yes, Ozzy would be dead without Sharon right now. I fully believe that.
I'd love if like his hand caught on fire after saying hocus pocus, hocus pocus, mumbo jumbo.
Oh, he accidentally just said like a spell and lit his hand on fire. That'd be great. I like how they have like really tacky decoration here too for such a rich guy. He has like the Rodin sculpture and then just a shiny cigar box. This is a great moment too. I really like this scene. It's genuinely creepy to me. The idea that Simon, who they have consigned to bed upstairs by himself, is lying there with the cross around his neck for protection. Of course, it's not going to protect him entirely. In fact, what he's about to do in a sort of trance-like hypnotic state is take his hand and tighten the cross around his neck until he is strangling himself to death. It's a very gruesome sort of death attempt scene for Hammer, because you're not really used to that. Usually people get like kicked off of high places or stabbed. They don't really have
the
like
Dracula movies are a little bit more bloody, but like
sure, but I mean it's they don't have like conceptual deaths.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like people get ripped apart by a monster, or they get drowned, or they get stabbed, or they get run over by a horse.
Yeah, or fall off a building, that shit.
But this is like genuinely creative. Like they're horror monster movie monsters, like they don't kill people in a creative way. You know what I mean? They kill them in the way that you expect them to, and that's what's scary about them. Whereas in this, it's like, wow, he could really get you in any number of ways, Mikata. Of course, the other really interesting thing about this scene, and I actually think this is where the editing strategy of this movie really works well, where they just cut out the explanation. He's like, they are satanic cultists, right? This entire time, he's been explaining to Rex what he thinks of the situation, and we can just cut away from it because we know. And here we're going to see the other really good part of this movie. In this scene where we start at the bed and we pan left to the window. If you will recall, as this little interlude began, we started with the camera facing the window and then we sort of swept right to reveal Simon on the bed as if something was entering through the window. But it's also a great moment of like directorial economy where you set up the window first as the point of entry and then you pan to Simon so you know where it came in from. And then also when you start with the empty bed afterwards and then pan to the window, you're like, oh, so I know where Simon left from. This is very simple, but it's like,
no, it's effective. Yeah, filmmaking.
That's what Terrence Fisher does. He's all about trying to be effective. This is one of those moments where the adventure espionage stuff is clumsy. They're just sneaking in through a window to a rich person's house.
Christopher Lee is 18 feet tall, so it's a little hard for him to fit through the window.
Also, the way they part the curtains is just hilarious to me. The fact that they did it right next to the fucking front door. Who are you hiding from? They could see you. It's the front door.
The other guy is just kind of like, kind of shoves his way through the window because he's not really sure how to get through it.
It's
not smooth.
It's like this stuff, and then when Rex tries to sneak into the trunk of that car.
I mean, he does it.
He does it. I'm like, this is silly.
That whole scene reminds me of the death of Stalin when like they're all trying to like
yes
for a position in the car line. Oh great, now I'm last to the Satan ritual.
Yeah,
Satan's
gonna Dennis Wheatley would agree with you. who was a very reactionary conservative man and apparently disgustingly racist if you look up stuff about the original book. But he definitely did not like communists and thought that they were harbingers of the apocalypse. Because you're godless heathens. Right?
Well, that's the
Lenin is Satan.
That's the thing I love is because it's different. But the modern day Church of Satan has a very strong social media presence.
Right.
And 80% of that is just Christians on Twitter tweeting at them of just like, be gone, devil, by the power of Christ's name. It's like
Christ emojis.
Yeah. And it's like, you're like, you realize we don't believe in God or Satan or anything like
we
that.
We only exist because we know this annoys you.
Yeah. Shout outs to the Church of Satan.
They're totally okay. They're just here to rib people. By the way, some of their stuff is genuinely, I think, like, you could say that it's just silly that they petition to, like, have Baphomet statues outside the courthouse because it's like, hey, if the Christians could do it. But also, it's like, they're right.
It's absurdism to, yeah. like
they're just revealing hypocrisy.
We don't think about it because Christianity is so normal in our society, but like, oh, wait, this is a religious thing sending a message, right?
Of course, when this movie came out in 1968, sort of, you have that 60s wave of paganism. That was a big deal at this time, but also a renewed interest in Satanism. Didn't Anton LaVey really start around the 50s, 60s?
60s, yeah.
Yeah, where you had like Sammy Davis Jr., right, was a Satanist, and then like, who else was it? I can't remember.
That was it.
No, you had a decent number of people. But then this year alone is such a big year for the idea of a cult. In just the public imagination, both in the US and the UK. I mean, you have like the Manson family definitely styled themselves as a type of cult. And of course, Rosemary's Baby connected with that as well. So lots of stuff going on. This is actually a very important year in horror. And it's interesting to compare this to Rosemary's Baby because it is just those two different sort of schools and sets of mind. However, I think this movie, which did not do super well for Hammer, unfortunately, which is why they didn't go ahead with the sequels. I think it was their attempt to try to catch up more with the times. I think they were just starting to be a little out of touch by 1968. And then once stuff like Night of the Living Dead and Rosemary's Baby comes out, it's sort of like overnight you realize that they were yesterday's sort of brand of horror. I mean, the fact of this coming out in the same year as Rosemary's Baby, I can't get over it. They belong in two different universes, you know? And part of that has to do, I think, with this sort of reactionary politics of this movie. What we're about to see here is this magical black man that's about to be summoned.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, which is, I think, another racist point in the book where he's like, he's supposed to be a djinn or something. But he's also, Max, he's a Polynesian and Haitian. Or something.
And a djinn. These are three separate things.
It doesn't matter.
It's racist, reactionary word vomit.
They're not English. They're not English, Max. So this is Dennis Wheatley's view of the world. Welcome. But an interesting thing about the reactionary version of this film, which is something we've come to expect from Terrence Fisher, right? We were making jokes earlier about like the sort of lack of female agency in this movie, but that's definitely something we've come to expect from Terrence Fisher. What's different about this movie's sort of conservative perspective is I think it's very much in relation to that idea of the British Empire in the 1920s and this older vision of the UK. This idea that they're sort of appealing to a sort of more Victorian, you know, swashbuckling idea of like conquest and the empire, you know?
I know it's the Tupac hologram.
He kind of is like that. Don't look at the eyes, Rex. They just get this fucking guy to stand there and be evil. Don't look at his eyes.
I feel bad for this actor.
Just stand there, dude.
Can you imagine being a black British actor in the 1960s and like you finally get cast for a role and it's like, okay. Make a weird face and wear this loincloth.
Or how about this? You're not an actor at all. And someone just stops you on the street and they're like, you look fucking weird. Do you want to be a demon? But yeah, so I think this movie has a very imperial view of everything that's going on. I'm going to say that some of the Sabbath stuff later, I feel like it maybe portrays that in a way that maybe you would not say is as close to the work and rituals of Aleister Crowley, right? Who is definitely the basis for Mikada.
Yes.
In this movie. In fact, in the original draft, he was even supposed to look like Aleister Crowley, where I think they describe him in the screenplay as a sleazy white slug or something.
I mean, he still does to a degree.
But. Yeah, kind of. But he's not like bulbous and like bald. You know, like they really wanted to lean into that.
Yeah.
But I feel like some of the rituals in this seem less like the stuff he might do and more like things that, you know, the colonial imagination of the British Empire would assume like the savages and God knows what other part of the world would do in their rituals. You know what I mean?
Well, like the thing about...
It's a xenophobic type of like celebration too.
Yeah, because I looked into Crowley not too long ago because you hear his name all the time and you're just like a famous devil worshipping guy. He didn't really do any of that. It was more just like mysticism and occultism more than anything. It was just like blending of a bunch of different cultures together. And I can't remember what it's called off the top of my head.
Thelemic?
Yeah.
Thelemic?
Something like that. But it's basically his own
Magic religion. The Gathering?
Yeah. I would be more willing to worship Magic the Gathering. I've played a fair amount of
these
that.
These cards have value.
Yeah. Listen, if you have a first edition Black Lotus, you don't have to work a day in your life.
Is that true?
Yes.
What is that?
It's a very rare card from the first edition. And if you have that card, you can sell it for millions of dollars.
Millions?
Yes. It's a very, very rare card.
Oh. I bet the worst celebrity owns that. It's going to be so irritating where like, fucking like Steve Manchin or whatever has like 10 of those in his house all framed. What?
I was about to go off on a whole tangent, but like, that's why I can never believe shows like Yu-Gi-Oh! Where they're just like, oh, you can win as long as you believe in yourself. It's like, no, if the rich people exist in this universe, they're just going to buy all the best cards.
It's true. Pokemon doesn't work either. They're going to have the best training. Pokemon is the most horrifying because it's like the police are, you're done.
The police are non-existent Pokemon. The only police officers...
Well, does that give you better chance for resistance against them?
Maybe. The only police officers you encounter are the ones that will attack you if you're out at night. They will literally challenge you to a Pokemon battle.
Oh, so it's like Maniac Cop
yeah.
meets Pokemon. That'd be interesting.
Nintendo, call us. We got ideas.
We got a pitch for you. The new darker Christopher Nolan-esque updating of Pokemon.
A sequel to Detective Pikachu. Nobody was expecting.
Oh my God, that'd be great. He's got to team up with Bruce Campbell.
Why not? I'd be 100% down.
To hunt down the maniac cop. A CGI ghost of Robert Zadar. Oh, speaking of women, he just abducted her. This is the scene we're at where Rex went to go pick up Tanith because he's got the hots for her. And apparently it was totally okay for this movie to assume, Max, that you could just go into a hotel, say to a woman, get in the car with me. I'll tell you why later while we're driving. And they just do it. She doesn't even know where they're going or why she's there. And she still agreed to get in the car with him. She does not know this man. What the hell is going on here?
No, I think this movie implies that they had like a one night stand or something. I think it's like
in a casino.
The casino.
He said he met her at like Monte Carlo.
Yeah, but it was like a casino hotel, I'm assuming. Like that's the vibe I got, is like that they had a like sort of a thing for like one night.
Okay, I'm willing to sort of go there. I would say that this movie is just their relationship is horrendously underdeveloped.
100%, yeah. I would agree with you. But like, that's the vibe I got off of it.
Yeah, we can try to fill it in on our own. Yeah.
So like,
oh, I'll just jump out of this car.
If you have an old lover that like you ran into at a party, and then like the next day they're like, "Hey, do you want to go get lunch to reconnect?" Like, one, why not? And two, if you're trying to keep
what the fuck's that like?
What? Oh, sorry. I'm on good terms with most of my exes, so. And two, like, if you're really trying to maintain your cover of totally not a Satanist, if somebody you're kind of familiar with invites you to lunch, it might just be.
but he invited her to lunch in the car. They were already in the car. But also, Max, the interesting thing about this, and just reveals to you the sort of reactionary pathologizing of women that Terrence Fisher will often engage in. In this scene, the dramatic basis of this scene is the idea that she is under some spell for Makata, right? And that because of that, Makata will, through her, get her to work some sort of resistance. Ooh, I love that image. His eyes in the windshield. That's great. But through her, Makata will get her to do some sort of resistance against Rex, and she will fuck up his plans and escape. Right, Max? That's the drama. But the interesting thing about that is that it can't even ascribe to her the basic level of subjectivity. Because the resistance is not coming from her being like, who the fuck are you taking me in your car, not telling me where you're going? It's coming from Makata. The resistance to Rex just randomly abducting her is the Satanists, and it's bad. It's not hers.
Oh, and then we get introduced to these characters.
Oh, yeah, the random family. With this girl, who has, she's pretend playing horsey, but she also has witches' brooms, Max. What's that mean?
It means that she...
Degradation of family values.
I was going to say she was the mastermind of the entire thing the whole time.
Really?
Yes. She is the witch.
That would have been a good twist.
No, there's no twists in this movie.
No. Not a one. Not one single fucking twist. Can you imagine how great it would be if it was real that Christopher Lee was the bad guy the whole time?
I mean, he looks like it. Like I said.
Yeah.
Like, that suit, the red pin, the goatee, the hat, the ivory-handled cane. Like, come
on. If you wanted to add yet another ending to this movie.
The fourth ending.
What you could do is that after they've done the space-time thing and the Angel of Death has taken Makata, Christopher Lee could be like, he's gone. Finally. And then he could like pick up his magic ring. But then you'd need a MacGuffin, right? That would give him power. Because the motivations are totally unclear. Yeah.
A tome.
He wants Simon and Tanith, but we don't know why. I think in the book, it's just because they're like special people because they're like astrological signs.
Oh no, the woman I kidnapped.
Dear God, a woman's driving. Stop her.
What the fuck did he think would happen?
He left the fucking keys in. He didn't even take the keys out.
That's like...
See, here's the stuff where Rex is doing things on his own, and it's just like, where's Christopher Lee?
He's at the library, don't worry. Getting some eggs and milk, or at the store, maybe.
He's doing what you should be doing during this scene. That said, it is okay to pay attention for the one moment where Christopher Lee, or I'm sorry, where Rex punches through the glass.
That's when I knew that I wasn't going to be horribly bored with this movie for the majority of it.
Oh, wasn't when they started fucking throwing hands in the first 2 seconds?
Well, no. I'm more particularly when Christopher Lee was not on screen.
Oh.
I knew that the movie still had some tricks to pull off.
The thing is, I appreciate the set pieces, but I don't buy it either.
I mean, obviously.
I mean, Rex is just too much of a loser, you know? He's just too much like, what's going on? Where am I?
Well, he knows nothing about the supernatural, and normally it's fine to have a character like that in your movie. But if you want to have a character who's like new to the supernatural, and that's good because you can explain it to your audience at the same time.
Yeah.
Have them be better at something else. Have them have more guns. Have them be like physically more imposing. Yeah.
He's incidentally here. Because he's friends with him. But also the fact that he doesn't know Max.
His window blue screened.
Yeah, that's exactly what happened. But the fact, Max, that he knows nothing about it, it like convolutes character motivations. Where it's like...
I think he just wants to fuck this chick and is seeing an opportunity to make it work for him.
Wow, he's really going for it. Can you imagine punching through your windshield because you wanted to fuck someone so bad and you were chasing them?
Well, I know dudes who punch through drywall all of the fucking time because they didn't get laid.
While chasing someone?
Not chasing someone.
It's not in response to not getting laid. It's like, the hunt is on. It's like his testosterone. I mean, his balls must be huge.
Car doesn't even have seats.
It doesn't even have wheels. It's just this balls rolling back and forth. Gives new meaning to the phrase rubber to the road. But this looks like Evil Dead almost.
Yeah.
Slamming a camera into a tree.
That's some fun camera work.
In Evil Dead, that would end with Bruce Campbell getting like a broken hand. And then they like...
In this one, he's fine.
Yeah.
He's just like a... Let me go to the nearest telephone booth to the woods.
We'll just make this expensive car look as fucked up as we possibly can while the owner is distracted.
He's never even like, sorry about the car.
He just leaves there.
Yeah.
But you know what? They're all so rich. Fuck them. Oh, he's got... That family has plenty of cars.
And horses, apparently. Unless the girl just has a helmet and horse whips that she likes to wear for no reason.
No horses.
Sweetie, we keep telling her there's no horses.
And this character is such a loser. He's just hitchhiking now. Okay, that's a camp. It did look like he almost did his own stunt, though, didn't it?
Almost.
Like he jumped out of the way of that car. That was pretty close to him, too.
Oh, so they do foreshadow this.
What?
The winged serpents.
What about them?
Well, because later on in the film, we have a girl being possessed, and they're asking her where Minotta is, and they're like, oh, it's a place guarded by the winged serpents. I can't go there. They do. They do set that up earlier.
I mean, Bernard Robinson is a big part of these movies, and he's great at just creating those sets that I think work. We didn't talk about it really, but it's interesting how in this movie he was tasked with creating sets that were really kind of out of his comfort zone or what he had been doing previously for Hammer, where there's no dungeons, there's no castles.
No dragons.
What?
Sorry.
What the hell does that even mean?
Dungeons and Dragons, leave me alone.
That's the fucking joke?
Yes.
Okay.
Listen, Austin. Christopher Lee's been gone for like 10 whole minutes now. I don't know when he's coming back. I'm scared.
I'm sweating. I need it. What the fuck was I? Oh, who even knows? It's just kind of boring with him. And there's too much incidental stuff. He incidentally happened to be close to the place he needed to get to anyway. You know? There's some weird plotting in this. And it all has to do with when Christopher Lee has to go run errands, which he does multiple times.
So the plot can happen.
Or you could just... Why can't you just have Christopher Lee do it? Was it too expensive? That's the only thing it could be, right? They could only get him for a few days. Because otherwise, there's no reason to have him not do this other than just the implausibility of a man the size of Christopher Lee fitting into a fucking trunk.
He just unfolds himself for like origami, like 18 pieces from the trunk.
It's like Alien when it climbs out of the wall.
Oh, my God. But like, I mean, you can tell he's giving an impassioned performance in this movie.
Everyone takes it seriously.
He's trying. It's not like, because in later Hammer films, he doesn't talk because he hated the screenplays so much. He's just like, no.
If anything, this might have been a reprieve from his terrible roles where he's like, I'm the villain and finally I have completed my revenge. Here we have the quaint ceremony, the black mass. Of course, very much just the same thing as a normal mass, except it's at night and in the woods.
Yeah. Like, you couldn't do this in the building you were in? Seemed like a fine place for it.
Honestly, this place seems pretty cool. It's a nice little clearing. Looks like they put some effort into those, like, chandeliers.
Yeah.
I like it.
I mean, it looks like a music festival, if we're being completely honest, but, like...
It looks like a community hall pagan ritual for, like, senior citizens' home.
Yeah, or, like... A summer camp, something like yes. that. We're doing like a Greek god thing at the summer camp. Now we're going to do our rituals.
I'm going to teach you about the ancient god Set and the goat of Mendes. Can the kids say goat of Mendes? Oh, there's the goat.
Oh, poor goat.
I bet the goat was nervous. It looks like it doesn't want to go near there. I mean, the thing about like working with animals like this, especially in these older films and their lighting styles too, is I imagine with older films, because they have much harder lighting, like those lights are just going to be brighter.
Fucking into it.
Oh, they're ready, Max.
You see that woman in the middle though, who's just like, oh yeah, fucking yeah.
Max, they're ready.
They are ready.
So the other weird thing about this movie, now that we're getting this scene again, with the cult, do you want to talk about the weird potential anti-Semitic element of this, which I don't fully understand, but I think it would be worthwhile to like look more into the book to understand this, where there's great emphasis placed on the Simon character being Jewish. And then also a lot of the crosses in this movie, in the book, it seems they're actually like swastikas. But listen, guys, it's the like cool peace swastika, as they explain in the book. It's not the bad white person swastika.
I mean, when was the book was written in the 30s, you said?
34.
Yeah, okay. So one...
1 year after.
Yeah, the crimes of Nazi Germany were not...
what they were.
They're not what they were, and the full extent of them was not known to the world at the moment. And as much as countries don't like to admit it, countries like the UK and America, they really liked Hitler's Germany.
They had no fucking problem with it whatsoever. Yeah. In fact, the only problem with it was that Hitler was too much what they would have aspired to do. They're like, listen, you're really good at doing this, like occupying other countries and getting their resources and everything, but like, don't do it to us, please. And then Hitler got too good at it.
If he had turned
took over Europe.
If he had turned on the Soviets before he started invading, like pushing.
The US would have allied with
Hitler.
Yes. Completely true, Max.
But this looks like a grand old time, dude.
Yeah.
I've been to raves that like look pretty much like this. Just a bunch of idiots like dancing like that.
But
like,
what do we see about this place? It's a multi-ethnic group. It's a very international group. And it looks like you have people from, I'm going to say notably, Africa and India, based on their garb in the first party scene too, where it seems to be places that were formerly like subject of the British Empire, kind of.
And places that their native religions were used as proof that they were inferior.
Yes.
Oh, are we doing day for night in this scene? Oh, yikes.
I mean, that sky is just blue.
Yeah.
But this is better. This bit is better. They did their best.
They did. It just sticks out because it's like supposed, like so obviously supposed to be night.
Just don't shoot the sky.
Yeah, that's all you had to do.
You know what, though? Through those several shots, they got it to match with the true night. And I'm glad they put the effort into getting true night for this Sabbath sequence because it really works better.
And that one...
the true black. Oh, they just poured blood on this poor girl.
Goat's blood.
It's so funny, the contrast, too, because Tanith gets the blood all over herself. And then Simon, and we're going to see it like the next shot. Just this really hot girl starts like grinding up against his dick. And she's just standing there with the blood all over herself. It's kind of like deadpan. Same thing with the shots with this, with like...
this looks like a grand fucking time. Like, I don't care. Like, 99.9% of the people here are enjoying themselves. Like,
she's just grinding on him, and Tanith is standing there being uncomfortable and covered in blood.
Yes, obviously, you should not pour goat's blood on people that you don't want to have goat's blood poured on them.
If they ask.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But other than that, everybody here is having a great time. Also, this is way more than 13, by the way. Just saying.
Yes, this is a little bit more than 13.
And this is the moment I fell in love with this film, ladies and gentlemen.
The Goat of Men. I'm going to say it's pretty great, the way they do it. It's just slightly out of focus.
Baphomet is... you don't get to see him too often in films. He's a good buddy when he shows up,
straight up just do it. They just straight up put him up there on that rock. And it's great. Now they cut into him. I kind of wish they hadn't done that, but there's going to be a shot here where it's genuinely fucking fantastic what they do, where they allow the heat distortion coming off of the big brazier to like be in front or in between the camera and Baphomet on the rock. And if they had just let that happen where he's only visible in the distorted air of the flame, this shot with Makata, and then he turns and points. Oh, and that point is great too. That moment, Charles Gray nails that moment. I think, where he points at him and he's like, now it's time. Come here. Love that. But yeah, that shot where you see Baphomet through the flames, perfect. It's so simple, and yet it's beautiful.
Although I have to say, they did not give Baphomet a singular tit, which would have completed what he's supposed to look like.
No tits.
Yeah.
Censors come for you. As we know, the UK in 1968 was purchased by Yahoo, and they immediately enforced new censorship laws.
And then, as we know, Hammer Films went on to try to get around this by, you know, like, their financial success was, like, sort of, like, tumbling down a cliff at this point. So they tried to recoup some of that with a website to reflect that called Tumblr.
Yes.
But then Yahoo eventually caught up to that.
Yes. Yahoo has been doing it for decades.
Ugh, fucking Yahoo. You and your strong anti-porn stance. I love Baphomet's reaction to that. He's like, oh, the light.
I love how... Yeah, they just throw. Basically,
they
okay.
just exploded it.
For anyone who's not watching this, it was this is just bedlam. This is insane.
This is the best scene in the film. I do not care.
So this
they're
is
they're just beating cult members. They exploded Baphomet.
So yeah, Rex is very gung-ho in this moment. And Christopher Lee's like, can we just fucking relax? And Rex is like, no. And Christopher Lee's like, okay, well, here's what we'll do. I'll drive the car and you hang on the outside like we're doing a fucking drive-by shooting. And you take this crucifix and we will do a drive-by shooting. I'll drive into the crowd and try to run over as many Satanists as I can. And then when we get close enough and blind Baphomet with the headlights, you're going to throw that thing like a bomb at him, that crucifix, which he does. Then it explodes. Rex jumps off the car, starts throwing people into the air and punching them, and then just picks up Tanith by like her hair and runs back to the car.
And now Tanith, after having some goat's blood poured on her, has realized that Satanism isn't for her. Like
goat's blood that they don't even bother to wash off for the rest of the movie. That's on her for the rest of the movie. I mean, come on, people. This is a real, like, we need help. Been a long night. So, Max, one thing I had not mentioned, which I anticipated bringing up much sooner, actually, was how very much this movie sort of interacts with those familiar Terence Fisher ideas of the strong patriarchal authority figures, right? We talk about this a lot in those other Hammer films. The idea that, you know, Terence Fisher seems to subscribe very much to that idea of philosopher kings, men philosopher kings. Yeah. And if you want a strong society, it needs to be led by a strong individual with conviction who has like certain capabilities and a will that will not sort of succumb to like base bodily desires. That's sort of Terence Fisher's thing. Scared of desire, scared of sex, but interested in that philosopher king idea of self-possession and knowledge and leadership. So his movies tend to be very reactionary and sometimes almost, what's the term? They seem to almost endorse like a hierarchy, you know, like that's probably the political system that Terence Fisher would subscribe to, you know, a monarchy or something.
But this worked so well last time that we left the...
Yeah, they'd keep doing the same things. That's another reason why this movie feels stop and start, is because it's like they do the same setup for the same type of scene over and over again. It's like you can only do it once. You need new scenes. But the interesting thing about having that very like centered on the male power thing is that Terence Fisher seems somewhat aware of that. And in his other movies, stuff like The Gorgon especially... he also examines what happens when the men fail to be adequately filling their leadership position as a philosopher king. So he examines things like impotence, inability to act or sort of control your desire. Those are things that scare Terence Fisher. it's definitely impetus in the idea of being turned to stone in the face of the male gaze in the Gorgon. In The Curse of the Werewolf, it's being unable to control your desire.
Speaking of controlling your desire.
Yeah, this guy doesn't know not to fucking kiss a woman covered in goat blood after she's been awake all night and was just saved from a satanic mass. I thought that was like day one as a guy. You knew that?
Sex ed. They teach you. Listen.
Welcome to high school sex ed. Let's start after the black mass.
We know that's where most of you are going to lose your virginity, so might as well get it out of the way.
But if some of you don't and your souls can still be saved, listen to me.
God, all the Christians were right about them teaching sex ed in school. It's just a Satanist ploy.
Yes. Truly was. And they do the same technique of even cutting out of the conversation while they're explaining it to them. Again, it's the same thing. So the other interesting thing in bringing up gender in this is how this is maybe the purest expression in maybe Terrence Fisher's entire filmography of those sort of dueling strong patriarchal figures. Where in the other movies we've sort of seen this with the Gorgon, it was Christopher Lee versus Peter Cushing. In Dracula, it's Christopher Lee and Peter Cushing as Van Helsing versus Dracula, right? That's a great example of it. But this one is even more pure, perhaps, because of what we're going to get with Makata and the type of magic he describes sort of in the upcoming scene, right? Where he talks about it just being a pure battle of wills.
Yeah.
The idea of magic being less so, it's not even sort of mind over matter, but mind over mind. And it's like, wow. So it's almost like, this movie is like, technically you could have the same type of drama from this movie with Christopher Lee sitting in an armchair and like psychically battling Makata, who's doing the same thing. So when it's just almost literally about a battle of wills between two strong patriarchal figures, I feel like it's a very sort of clear distillation of that interest for Terrence Fisher. And of course, another part of that we also get here is the sort of, duality between the stronger, more reliable, and in control older patriarchal figure, and then the younger man who would become the older figure but has trouble controlling and regulating their desire. Where Rex.
I love how he was literally just waiting behind the bush.
Yeah, he's just waiting.
What if Christopher Lee had stopped and gotten out of the car and was like,
I'll beat your ass now.
What are you doing?
Interestingly enough, Charles Gray, also a James Bond villain, he was Blofeld. Thinking Diamonds Are Forever?
Sure.
I
was never a huge James Bond fan.
Yeah, me neither. I think he could be quite... I wish he had gotten more opportunities in this movie. I don't like the way he treats his villain, you know? Like, I think he's a very capable actor. He's not as good as Christopher Lee, and I don't think he's as imposing as Christopher Lee, but he can be very threatening if you introduce him in the right way. This scene, Max, is my favorite scene in the movie. This conversation between Makata and then this woman with the red hair. The mother? Mom? What's her name?
Yes.
Yeah, Mom. Between Mom and Makata, my favorite scene in the movie where he tries to hypnotize her and then get to, through hypnotizing her, take... both Tanith and Simon, after they have dealt with both this woman and the father, killed them. It's great because he clearly seems very malevolent right away, but that also doesn't stop him. And it's the moment he starts to talk, it's like already too late. There's something very dangerous about him, despite how smarmy he is. Whereas in the first scene we actually see him, he has the same sort of smarmy face, but he's just like chewing on hors d'oeuvres, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, okay. You know what, Max? If this movie was perfect for me, I would actually have it begin with this scene.
Really?
Yes. And maybe this is how he like takes away Tanith and Simon, or, you know, something like that. You change the plot up a little bit. But I would begin it with this scene and not explain what's happening. And then you see what he's doing. And it makes him so dangerous already because it's just talking, you know? He doesn't have to be as tall as Christopher Lee. He can just talk to him, right? Because when you see Christopher Lee first, you're like, who can beat this man?
They're trying to not have you not walk out of the theater immediately.
Yeah. And you're right. It would be sort of a chance to begin a movie this way, where you just have this conversation and they seem to not be talking about anything. And it takes like a solid 3 minutes, maybe 3, 4, 5 minutes to get to the point where it's actually dramatic and there's like psychic stuff going on. But I think the payoff would be great. Because once you see him do this, anytime you see him after where he's in like a parlor room setting, you know he's dangerous immediately. I just think it sets up the stakes really well. And as it stands in this movie, you see him like chewing on food and getting upset with Simon. And then you see sort of evidence of like the spirits he's conjured to do his work for him. But you don't really get any sort of direct contact with him before this scene. You just see him doing the mass or whatever. And the only reason you know he's dangerous before this is just because of you take Christopher Lee's word for it.
I mean, you do also see him like in the mirror of the car controlling Tanith's mind and like, yeah, I guess other than that, no.
I guess I just still find it a little bit indirect. Whereas I feel like if you begin with this scene, all that stuff hits a lot harder, you know? Like, I guess what I'm saying is, even if he was controlling Tanith, that's not something he's literally doing to destroy someone. That's just him manipulating Tanith. You know, if you open with a scene where he's immediately using these powers to directly, while he is there in person, to cause damage to this family so that Simon strangles the husband, right? And that they can escape, you know what he's capable of right away and you don't want to fuck with him. But the part of that too, and I think that speaks to the reactionary ideology of this movie, is that because he doesn't do anything threatening directly and in person until this moment, when you say that he's dangerous, it's just because he's a Satanist and no other reason. It's not because of the evidence of what he's actually done firsthand. You know what I mean? It's just because he's different. It's like getting back to that xenophobia kind of thing.
This scene is interesting because everything he just said, that long monologue, was basically to numb her mind to allow him to infiltrate that.
Yeah.
But the points he was making was like interesting points of like, there's technically no good or evil when you're considering magic. It's the power of change and like all of its superstition. But it's almost like the film, and I'm assuming the novel as well, is like, oh, anybody who's making these good faith arguments are really just trying to hypnotize you to get you under their black magic spell.
Yeah, because the movie starts from, like, this is what we were talking about in the introduction too, where this movie, I just love this push in, by the way. Great camera work from Terrence Fisher to know to push in like this during this sort of hypnotizing scene. I just think it works perfectly. It's great. I want his character to get more scenes like this. He really doesn't. I mean, he's truly threatening in this scene. If you begin with this scene, I feel like, oh, this is a guy who could take on Christopher Lee. I have no doubt. But what you're saying about that, the way that this movie and the book arrive at a conclusion about the satanic cultists immediately, that gets back to what we were talking about with The Fantastic, right? And for anyone who hasn't listened to any number of our episodes where we discuss this, The Fantastic is a critical term we love to bring up because it's very useful. The Fantastic exists on the spectrum between the marvelous on the one hand and then the uncanny on the other hand. And it's very useful when talking about any sort of movie or text that happens to have some sort of supernatural phenomena, right? Something that's out of the ordinary. So the idea is that on the uncanny side, the weird phenomena is proven not to be supernatural at all. There is a real world explanation for it. It's a Scooby-Doo ending, right? You take the mask off the monster. It's actually just some person who wanted money. The other side of this spectrum is the marvelous, where it's the opposite. You try to take the mask off the monster and, oh no, it's a real monster because it's an actual real supernatural phenomena event. The world of the marvelous is not our own world. It is a world where this magical thing now exists. And the fantastic is a text that sort of oscillates between them. And a great example of that is something like The Turn of the Screw by Henry James, where there's no true conclusion that is ever arrived at about the true nature of this phenomena by the movie. And this movie participates sort of in the Marvelous because, as you said earlier, there's no pausing to question. Oh, God, I just spilled a bunch of stuff.
God fucking damn it, Austin.
There's no pausing to question whether or not any of this is real. We know the Satanists are real. But furthermore, Max, there's no pausing to question the morality of anything that's going on either. It's not only that we know they're real, it's that we know they're evil. You know what I mean?
I mean, so far, all we've seen them do that's bad is kill a goat.
Yeah, and then conjure a Jamaican djinn or whatever.
They didn't do that. Christopher Lee did that.
No, he didn't. Accident. That was a trap that Mikata left for them.
Could be.
But also, they were trespassing, so I don't know what the fuck you want.
If you take your preconceived Christian notions out of here.
Which this movie never does.
Yeah.
And that's my point. Is
all
that
I'm saying is the Satanists, up until that moment, haven't really done anything that bad.
It reminds me of Starship Troopers, where it's like they're inventing a motivation for these people, like these evil bugs. And it's like, do you actually know that? Have you tried to talk with the bugs?
In the meantime, our heroes have run over people with a car, beat the shit out of many other people, continuously kidnapped their friends and a poor woman.
Punched their friends.
Yeah. Who are just trying to join this religious cult that they don't like.
And then crash their friend's car.
Yes.
But it must be done in the name of Jesus.
Oh, God damn it. I have to kidnap her again now.
Getting real tired of this. He runs like a dandy. He runs like fucking Ansel Elgort, making me sick.
You have something against Ansel Elgort.
I do have something against him. Why the fuck don't you?
I don't know enough about Ansel Elgort to have something against him.
I think you better start. The only thing keeping me sane nowadays.
This is like... good. You should have killed him. He's abducted you several times, man.
Yeah, and there's no development of the relationship at all. So it just doesn't work. It just does not work. One point I feel like I didn't finish making either, just to finish off that comment about the potentially anti-Semitic nature of this, is just relating it to that internationalism, that sort of idea of the cosmopolitan sort of Jew that we know was big in the 30s because Hitler used it as propaganda. We talked about this in our To Be or Not To Be episode. The idea of like these urbane Jewish people who had access to money, and because they were sort of transatlantic, were cut off from like a national identity, you know? So it's been something that's been used as like this, you know, theorizing about the idea of some cabal or whatever that secretly controls things. And of course, you can combine that with a sort of like imperial discourse of this movie. The idea that it's like these sort of formal British imperial subjects are now banding in this sort of international union that are going to corrupt the sort of values and belief system of the sort of British aristocracy from the inside out. And that's why this movie really is reactionary, is because it doesn't seem to have like a very, it doesn't have a positive belief system that it's offering. It's just everything that happens is in response to the sort of anxiety produced by the presence of Satanism. You know what I mean, Max?
Yeah.
It's not like Christopher Lee he's like, I'm on a mission from God. He's just like, this is bad and I know it's bad.
I'm a professor of magic.
Evil. I've studied evil. There's lots of these moments too, where people are just like, they do these weird things where they cut out like unnecessary explanation scenes where they're giving exposition. But then they have these moments where it's just like, oh, they're talking about fucking dinner and waking up Christopher Lee and helping him get his jacket on. Do we need this?
Do we ever explain why they can't eat? They can only drink water?
It's part of the ritual. It's a whole big thing with some rituals in I don't know, left-hand path magic or whatever. The idea that you have to fast for however many days before you can do it.
Oh, don't. Dude. It's not a good look, man.
Can I just kiss you once? It'll help you breathe. I have air to give you.
You know that's going back in her mouth, right, buddy?
He's going to put it in his mouth first.
No. That's just been me fighting because you tied me up and put me in a barn.
It's not because Mikata is possessing me and I'm resisting it. You actually just hog-tied me and it was very uncomfortable. Don't you understand that I can think things? I'm not just Makata's vessel. Which again, something, if we want to compare this to the Gorgon, I think you actually could on the basis of possession. It's also a possession movie. But that one is far more interesting to me. The possession. Just because that movie is much more interested in gender.
Just, I love imagining being the guy in this. I mean, because he's the second skeptic we have in the movie. And can you imagine, like, your wife's uncle shows up at your place and it's like, we need two bedrooms. And also, we need to conduct the magical ritual in your living room.
And this chalk cannot be erased.
Sorry, it's just going to be there now.
It's going to be on your floor forever. But, well, we can get you several new trees for the floor. I knew a great man in South Africa who wears a pith helmet who can give me the trees.
Just all of the trees.
Yes. I hear there's lots of them in Darkest Africa, as it's called.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
That's the attitude of this movie. Although less so than the book, I understand. It might seem weird, but this movie, I think, from what I've read, again, I have not read any of Dennis Wheatley's books, seems to have cut down on the imperialism, the rah-rah imperialism and the...
Well, the 60s weren't a great time for the British Empire.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's also why this movie is sort of as quaint as it seems for 1968. Very timely, because it is voicing that anxiety of the older generation against the idea that it's like, oh no, our empire is done. Not only is our empire is done, is now we have these hairy kids like Mick Jagger. What the fuck is going to happen now?
The Beatles.
Oh, I've got to lock up my daughter from Mick Jagger. Bowie.
What the fuck even is he? Yeah, he's got those moves like Jagger.
Oh, please jump off the balcony.
Okay.
Did you just make a Maroon 5 joke?
Yes.
Wow.
That year.
What year?
Because that year, it was like I had a conspiracy that Mick Jagger was using his ties in the music industry to keep himself relevant. Because a couple years before that, you got a TikTok by Kesha, which has the line, the boys are lining up because they hear we got swagger, but we kick them to the curb unless they look like Mick Jagger. And then we got moves like Jagger a couple years after that.
Is Mick Jagger really famous for his beautiful face?
No. That's why I was saying, like, or his dance moves. So I think that he was just like,
I think he was more famous for being like, the Mick Jagger.
Yeah.
And then also like being skinny and doing drugs and yelling.
Exactly.
Which, so, as far as I'm concerned, I prefer people to be famous for that. Don't trust hot people. You know who you should trust is a guy who looks like Mick Jagger and is like, blah, 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 blah. They're better.
Danny DeVito.
Yeah.
You can trust Danny DeVito.
Yeah.
You meanie.
I do like a lot of the touches of red in this movie. That's another motif from Terrence Fisher where he uses red a lot, usually in a much more restrained way, I think, to signify the presence of the supernatural or something scary is about to happen. But he uses it quite a bit in this movie, and I think it's a big part of the color palette, but it works very well. He's able to sort of contrast it and sort of motivate it within the setting very well, I think. So it never really pops out to you unless you're looking for it. Of course, that could also just speak to more of Bernard Robinson's great set design.
Oh, right next to me. I forgot.
It's been a while.
It's been a while.
Oh.
You got to stop saying these things.
What is it with these weird callback jokes? Do you want to just finish the song now?
No.
No, do it. Go ahead. It's been a while. Do it.
Just imagine, like, I relate to this guy so much.
What, being trapped in a circle?
No, just like, he's like, what the fuck are you talking about, Christopher Lee? This guy said the water tasted nasty, and Christopher Lee's like, no, it's all part of his plan.
Honestly, this alternate story of this could just be like from this other dude's point of view, whose house they're in. It's like his friends show up and they're just charismatic, but they're also on like a shared bad trip.
That sounds like the next Ari Aster movie.
And he's just like has to roll with it because he doesn't want to offend them.
Oh, not Ari Aster. Who's the fucking asshole who made Enter the Void?
Oh, Gaspar Noé.
Yeah, I hate him. But that sounds like a movie that he would make. I guess that's what Climax kind of is, but.
His movies just seem really pointless to me.
I, on record, Enter the Void is one of the worst movies I've ever seen in my life. Like, I really just hate it.
Is it worse than The Revenant?
You know what? Yes.
Ooh.
There are things I like about both movies. Like, yes, you use naturalistic lighting in The Revenant, and yes, Enter the Void has some very charming miniature shots. I hate most of the rest of the movie, but The Revenant, at least I liked Tom Hardy's acting in that movie. He was very good in it.
Yeah.
Enter the Void had none of that to latch on to.
Also, The Revenant looks beautiful.
Yeah.
I also think the bear fight is actually really funny. It goes on for so long, and then it ends with the bear like just like falling on him. It's just like a final insult from the bear.
Fuck you.
That's exactly what it's like. Yeah, I think the bear fight scene is really funny. And if I was directing that movie, I would actually stretch out the bear fight scene to make it like 30 minutes long. Just so you're like, what the fuck?
Just have it be like the reverse of the Gray, where like that movie marketed itself as Wolf Fight the movie, and then like that's the last 10 seconds of the film.
I actually think that movie's not bad.
No,
I'll be honest with you.
I know. It's just like it's not what it marketed itself to be at all. And then
yeah,
have The Revenant be like, oh, it's this big natural like story of... Yeah, survival and revenge, and then just have it be 2 hours of bear fight.
Not just bear fight. It's like the bear wins immediately, and it's 2 hours of it just like throwing him back and forth. Oh, a spider!
It's a spooky spider, everyone. Excuse me?
Yes, the spider of ambiguous size.
Yeah, they did not do a good job on
Sounds
this.
Sounds like a Monty Python villain. You're going to awaken the spider of ambiguous size. Yes, a lot of the people making this were not very satisfied with the special effects. In fact, some of the special effects in this movie were left uncompleted, Max.
I would believe that for a lot of the car scenes. Oh, God.
But also, it doesn't look the fucking worst. I mean, the problem is going back and forth. I wish they had just stuck to one method or the other, you know? If you're going to use a miniature tarantula, you somehow have to find a way to mat all of them into the circle with the miniature. But don't switch back and forth between the miniature and then just sort of matting it onto the wide shot of with them in the circle. You know what I mean, Max? Because it just looks different. Maybe you have to for this moment where it attacks Peggy.
But it doesn't.
Oh, there he just elbowed his friend again. Oh, now it's time to do something about this.
You dissolved our daughter.
Let the bodies hit the floor. Let the bodies hit the floor. Oh, we got the tarantula.
Why didn't we just do that in the first place?
I don't know.
How to show off those 6 special effects that you had, guys?
The real 6 special effects are coming up next. I do like this set piece, though, just, you know, despite all of this. I think it's fun. You don't get a lot of scenes like this in the rest of Hammer's filmography. Although you do start to see them sort of lean towards more sort of set piece spectacles rather than just like trying to get like acting talent to be the spectacle. I think as they go into the 70s and you get stuff like Vampire Circus, and stuff like that. But there's some fun moments in that. But it, in my mind,
that
it's...
that was a weak punch there, guy.
Yeah, that was a bad fake punch. But in my mind, Hammer starts to rely less on the spectacle of like their actors being the star power and more just like conceptual stuff. And of course, they were taking advantage of, you know, further loosening censor laws, you know, too. So, I mean, they had to find some sort of way to try to compete with the US, which by 1968, as we've established, Rosemary's Baby, it cannot be understated, Rosemary's Baby and Night of the Living Dead, that's like a light year step in the film, like the film taxonomy of horror. And overnight.
Sorry, wait, I,
what?
I'm sorry. I just, because we very quickly, right there.
What?
Christopher Lee mentions he has the power to destroy space and time by knowing this one ritual.
Yes, which he refuses to invoke.
Until later on, when we need the plot to end up, because we've already had three endings. We can't have an unsatisfying ending after three endings. So,
but they do have an unsatisfying ending. I think the ending is the weakest part of this movie. Oh my God, I love this.
It's the White Rider.
They really had to stretch the material they had because apparently this horse was very old. Its name was like Nilbog or something.
Nilbog is goblin backwards. Yeah.
I think it was like Nelly or something like that. It was a very old horse, and apparently they had a very hard time keeping a firm grip on the floor.
Aww.
On their hooves. Apparently it was a little bit slippery for them.
Shit everywhere. Horses are disgusting animals. As they do. That's another controversial hot take that I have. Horses are shit animals.
Wow. Have any others?
We'll get there. Gotta save them.
Okay. Can unload. That's all we've got, folks.
Can't unload all of my spicy takes in one thing. Oh, God. Remix.
Remix horse attack.
Oh, he took his mask off.
You know what's funny is that they say not to look at it, and the dad over there is looking straight at it. And then they cut to the reverse shot, and he's covering his eyes. But when Christopher Lee invokes the angel to go away or whatever, he's looking straight at it. Now, Max, let me ask you something. Did you think it was cool how when it lifted the mask up, that it was just weird blue behind it?
No.
Did you know that there was an unfinished effect?
I kind of figured, yeah.
I didn't figure. I thought it had just gone like surreal for a moment, right? Where it opens, it's like, I thought it had done like an EC Comics thing almost. And it was like snap zoom. It takes its head off. There's the skull. And now there's this surreal blue background. I kind of think it works.
Yeah, it could. I always just kind of got it as like, yeah, an unfinished composite effect, but like there's a lot of those in this movie. So not to that degree, but
that one is just literally like,
it's small and quick, that one. So it's easily forgivable, but
well, it's so blatant that you almost assume it can't be that. Now, there was a very controversial restoration of this, I think in 2012, where they actually filled in special effects on that, and they made it like blue glowing flames behind it. And people had some opinions on it. I got to say, I do think the weird blue screen mistake actually kind of works. Because if you think of it, Max, the camera is zooming in on something that you can't technically be allowed to see.
How do you mean?
Meaning he said, don't look at it or it'll kill you. Do you know what I mean? So if you want to motivate the camera of actually making eye contact and looking at the face of this thing that will kill you, it's helpful to add in some surrealism because it's like, wow, there's like an effect to looking at this.
Yeah.
You understand it.
I get it. Couldn't they have killed Rex? Couldn't have the Angel of Death taken Rex's soul instead?
No.
You useless fucking butler.
Now, Max, the one other big thing that I hadn't really brought up at this point in the movie that I thought I was going to sooner, going back to the idea of how this movie plays with gender, and of course something that we've talked about with other Terrence Fisher movies, is that idea of homosocial relationships. The idea of sort of most typically in the films we talk about, the connection between men and homosocial relationships being a sort of relationship that is based on the exclusion of women, often in movies, and it's something that maintains sort of a hegemonic patriarchy. And I think that's a big part of this movie, and it's a big part of the character motivation that keeps Christopher Lee going to save his friend Simon, because otherwise it's like, why can't you just let him make his own decision? I know part of the basis of inspiration for the book actually, and these characters, was the Three Musketeers, because I think that was a favorite book of Dennis Wheatley's. And that makes a lot of sense. It's this sort of group, this collection of men that are bound together as brothers or whatever. It's a homosocial bond. And they sort of, it's all about the sort of, I don't know, the loyalty to one another above all else, right? And of course, this movie begins with them meeting for their annual reunion, right? So yeah, that's what they got to do. And that's why he's fighting with Mikado over this. And another big part of that is, where did Simon live at the start of this movie? He lived at a club, apparently, before he got a house. Which clubs are just giant frat houses for rich people from the 20s, where older aristocratic rich men would live there their whole lives if they didn't have wives or children. And they would get maids and people to clean up after them. Oh, here we have him invoking Osiris.
I was going to say earlier on, though, he invokes the four archangels. And that's like, besides him having like a cross that he uses to explode demons, that's the first explicitly Christian thing we see him do, is invoke the archangels. But then we immediately invoke Egyptian gods as well.
Well, Egyptian gods is a big part of like Thelemic magic with Aleister Crowley, right? Especially Set, right? But also, I think the four archangel thing is a big part of the occult as well, with the acknowledgement of four archangels on every side of you or something during rituals or some shit like that. So yeah, one other thing about the homosocial interactions too is this idea that it interacts with the sort of Oedipal character progression that we often see in these movies, where usually we describe that as the type of plot line in film where a male character will achieve some sort of trajectory in their arc by possession of the female sex object, right? This is how you assert yourself as a male adult in these movies, is to possess a woman, and that means you've matured. But not just that, you possess a woman at the expense of the father. You have to ward off the competitor for the woman. So the interesting thing in this movie, though, is that it flips that relationship, and it's almost like the Oedipal third is Simon that is caught between Makata and Christopher Lee. Sort of like an interesting inversion.
And then Christopher Lee's about to go off the fucking deep end right here and force this woman's spirit to die.
Force Tanith to... Yeah, I mean, that's the other thing, too, is that Christopher Lee has a very cold attitude towards Tanith. He seems to not care about her at all. He only cares about Simon. I don't know if you caught this when they show up at the Black Mass. Rex is like, we need to save Tanith, too. She's not been baptized yet. And then Christopher Lee goes, well, we'll do what we can.
Yeah.
It's like, but wait, don't you want to save her, too? And of course, the homosocial element, I think, also speaks to like the weird anxiety over the sexual desire present in the satanic cult. The idea of engaging in an orgy, you know?
Yeah.
It's that weird conservative sex anxiety lashing out once again. Well, here Simon just drives on up to the place.
Well, no, because we established earlier that we had winged serpents on those gates, and now we're using that knowledge later on.
Do you think the occult film has truly evolved since this? You have Rosemary's Baby in 1968. How does it evolve after that? I would say the next big milestone I can truly think of, although I'm sure I'm overlooking some, is a movie that's going to be like
The Omen, I would say, is the next big one for me.
Yeah.
The Omen is like the next like cultural milestone occult movie.
But The Omen is also just an offshoot of Rosemary's Baby. In the sense that it's taking the very much same idea. And I think it's taking things that Rosemary does through implication and then making it the explicit content of the film, where The Omen is more explicitly political than Rosemary's Baby, but I think is ultimately not more political than Rosemary's Baby in the end. Because in Rosemary's Baby, that's all bottled up inside the sort of domestic space. And also some of Mia Farrow's dreams, too. The idea of, like, the, you know, the Catholic Church and politics and stuff like that. But also, I would say a big sort of major thing that I would count as a milestone is Eyes Wide Shut is, in my mind, a big occult movie that, even though it's definitely gotten a big sort of critical reevaluation, I think, in the last 10 years, where it was previously known as not a good movie by a lot of Kubrick fans who seem to be disappointed with it, I think in the last 10 years it's really come around to be very appreciated. I think it's a fantastic movie. I think it's very explicitly political. And then I think the next big milestone after that, you have to wait till Get Out.
Yeah.
Which could not be a cult depending on how you categorize it.
It's not. It's a scientific film, but also it's more of a... I wouldn't agree with you there. And I think there's a lot of stops in between there as well. But like... a cult is literally a film trying to be political and teach you that just because you're a white, well-meaning liberal doesn't mean that you're not... don't have incredibly racist actions and implications.
But they do form a secret cabal.
I mean, they do, but...
I guess the difference would be like... do you view it more as a type of a cult film?
No.
Or a type of folk horror film? Something akin to The Wicker Man. Do you view The Wicker Man as a cult horror film?
Well, cult, I would have to say there has to be some supernatural element to it.
Does there?
Yes.
Or does it have to just be the presence of the cult menacing these people? Eyes Wide Shut doesn't have supernatural stuff, but I would say that's definitely an occult movie, even if I wouldn't necessarily categorize it as horror right away. I think this is definitely a movie that markets itself as an erotic thriller, but it's also an occult movie, despite that. I don't know. It's an interesting question, though. I think the genre of the occult has seen a sort of revival in the last 5 to 10 years, though. I think there's no arguing about that.
Oh, no. I mean, you do have movies like we were talking about before, like the Midsummer.
Hereditary as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. Both sort of bigger art house hits. And again, I would offer Get Out as a type of movie like that.
I love the idea of that guy just standing outside the door holding the little girl waiting for the guy to open.
Hey, you gotta follow the rules of the ritual, Max.
It's very specific. A lot of these symbols are very... I forgot to mention until near the end of this fucking podcast, but I brought my copy of the Necronomicon here.
What is the Necronomicon? The Necronomicon Ex Mortis?
Yes. No, that's the one from The Evil Dead.
That's the better one.
The Necronomicon, at least the version I have, this is excerpts from the writing of H.P. Lovecraft and then fleshed out into an entire theoretical tome of how to summon and resist the influence of demons and higher powers and whatnot, and what moons and what to sacrifice and all sorts of fun things.
What moons?
Yeah, and what moons to perform, what rituals and whatnot.
Oh, okay.
I find it fun just as sort of like an expanded universe and like almost a cool prop to have.
Well, the reason you looked that up is because we were looking to try to perform some sort of evocation ritual at the start of this episode. I thought that would be a fun treat for you listeners. We could not... oh, God, more punching.
Rex's one character trait of punching Satanists.
That's the one thing he does, is that he does it, but he only does it when Christopher Lee's like, don't do it right now. Do it in 2 minutes. And he's like, no, I'm doing it now. Then we have this disaster ending. I will say, though, this has a great similarity, as disappointing as this ending is for me, Max. I think there's a great similarity between this film's ending and City of the Dead. Although City of the Dead, I think, nails the exploding Satanists a little bit better. Because that one, it's almost like a force field emanating from the giant cross that this asshole is carrying after he has like a dagger sticking out of his back. The ending of that movie is just great. Oh, I love City of the Dead so much. In this one, the spell doesn't happen in such a metal, awesome way.
Oh, wow. You did a lot of good there, buddy.
He didn't even get to punch one Satanist. He got knocked out by a guy wearing fucking glasses. How embarrassing. We all know if you wear glasses, you're just the biggest nerd ever. You're not cool at all. Obviously joking. We love people who wear glasses.
Also, there's not 13 of them again. They're really fucking bad at this.
It'd be funny if Christopher Lee just realized that and he's like, well, we have nothing to be worried about.
Wait.
It's actually going to be hilarious. You're going to see how frustrated he's going to get. He didn't even get the right number of people. And he's supposed to be an ipsissimus? Please. Listeners, if you have any other suggestions for how we can actually evoke Satan and bring him onto the podcast as a guest for any of our other Halloween episodes, please let us know. Please. And do not send us those condescending messages about how you do not know what you're meddling in and how it takes years of experience to get used to that. Yeah, please spare us the fictional consequences of your nonsense.
I have, in a slightly less condescending way, I have friends in various spiritual and witchy communities, and I would tell you that most of them would say that it's more of the faith behind the actions that invoke
it. So you could say anything.
You can say, like, if you're not being serious and just being like, oh, I summon the devil, it's not going to do anything because you're not sending...
But you have to mean it.
Yeah, you're not sending that energy out there.
But technically, I could, if I really meant it, I could go out onto the balcony and try to summon Satan by yelling, like, Ronald Reagan, into the void.
Well, then you'd just summon a conservative to come talk to you, so that's pretty much...
That sounds awful.
Exactly. That's like summoning the devil.
Satan would be like, you deserve this. Oh, what's this? The light? Oh, my God, explosion. I mean, the explosion itself is great, but how we get there is just lame as shit.
And they start reacting like afterwards. They're like, oh.
Oh, also, they're not on fire. They're just like turning into dust.
All their cloth stuff is on fire.
No, all their materials are on fire.
But there's Jesus there the entire time.
Jesus was watching.
I should have had that taken down.
That's exactly what his response was. I was like, oh, shit. We knew we should have taken care of that. Oh, man. I was just so excited to get that giant fucking hanging wall, a floral pattern up on the wall. Covered that cross up and I forgot about it.
And now we come to the actual end of the film. The third ending.
This is the part where it would be great if it was like Christopher Lee was the villain. Of course, in order to do that, you would have to have characters who are competent and like likable enough to actually like challenge him in some way. Which, I'm skeptical, Max. I do not know if that's something this movie possesses.
It could have if it was written slightly differently. Because the people do challenge Christopher Lee throughout all of this. They're just presented as idiots for having the idea to ever fucking question Christopher Lee.
There's a number of different things you could have done with the characters in this. Some you could have gotten rid of. Some you could have focused on more. But there's a bunch of different combinations you could have tried to make it more interesting and more of a counterpoint to Christopher Lee. Like, I just realized it would have been interesting to see the... if you did want to do the Christopher Lee evil ending, which of course they didn't because they thought this was going to be serious potentially. It would have been nice to see the mom character pick up on it. She seems to be very receptive to the supernatural.
And she tries to hold her own against Makata and does better than
most
you would expect people to. Yeah.
She takes it, she next to Christopher Lee, she takes it the most seriously in the movie. So I don't know. It's just interesting. It would have been interesting to see her if she realizes her child is still in danger, but the other men sort of don't see it the way she does. She could recognize that evil nature potentially in Duke de Richelieu. But this is all just our fan fiction ending. This was never in the cards for what was going to happen in this movie. Here we have the explanation about how we just retconned everything that just happened.
The movie, it's over now.
I still kind of don't understand it. What was it that made the space and time fall apart? Was it when he invoked the possession? So he told Tanis to take possession of Mom? Is that what it was? That was the spell? Or is it some other thing that he said that made them explode?
I think Tanith took over the Mom again and did a spell to do that.
Oh, so Tanith said had the girl recite the space-time spell.
Yeah, but the Angel of Death had already been summoned, and since Tanith's soul was in the living world again...
Yes.
I think they said he took Mokata's soul now, so yes. He can't come back.
That makes sense to me. It's just the mechanics of how we got there is a little bit like, what?
The ending of this movie is very wonky, and also it could have ended before the explosion in the basement scene. So,
yeah. But yes, that is it. That's The Devil Rides Out. Yeah. One last thing to mention, of course, is something we bring up in all these horror movies, is in reference to gender and women particularly. The idea of women being open spaces, of being grottos, of being portals to the supernatural, of being closer in proximity to the supernatural. Something Carol J. Clover talks a lot about in Men, Women, and Chainsaws, and you for sure can count on me to include some of that in the show notes. I will. But I just thought that was another thing worth mentioning in this movie. But yeah, this is just a really fun Hammer movie, another really fun one. I think it's just a great Christopher Lee performance.
It really is.
Yeah.
If you're a fan of Christopher Lee, you owe it to yourself to see this. If you do not like Christopher Lee,
why are you listening to this?
Yeah, fuck you, first off. But secondly, there's still a lot of fun, campy Satanist imagery in here that
yeah,
not a lot of movies have the balls to get away with these days.
Decent set pieces. Yeah.
Now we have to pussyfoot around it of just like, oh, it's no. These are fucking devil worshippers, and they are more than happy to tell you that. Like,
yeah. You do have to admire the bluntness. And sometimes, like you're saying, Max, it is just good to be like, not only they're Satanists, we're telling you right away, and we're going to punch them.
Yes.
I do enjoy when a movie like doesn't spend time building up to the thing you normally think it would, and it's like, oh, now we can go in a new direction because you already started out at just punching them. Sometimes you have to wait a whole movie to punch them.
Wow, no, there's so much devil worshiping punching in this movie.
If this movie has a major flaw, it's that it didn't overcome its inconsistencies by having more punching.
There you go.
That would have been the big...
It didn't subvert our expectations by having yet more devil worshippers punch.
Yes. It should have had way more than 13. So yes, if you want to listen to way more than 13 episodes of the Spectator Film Podcast, you can find us at spectatorfilmpodcast.com or whatever the fuck our name is on Letterboxd. I don't know it. Or on our social media, on Instagram and Twitter. I don't know the names to those either. You'll have to go to our website, spectatorfilmpodcast.com, where we have done episodes on so many other Hammer movies, so many other fun horror movies. We're going to continue doing more fun movies for you guys here from the post-apocalypse, the semi-post-apocalypse, the ongoing apocalypse. And Max, do you have any other words to say? Any final thoughts on the movie? Or you just said that?
Z-dinger on the compound, Z-dinger key on the... Okay, I'm not going to even try. This is fucking nonsense written in the Necronomicon.
Wow, okay, so you went for the bit, and you didn't even commit.
Sounds like the entire history of the Spectator Film Podcast.
Oh, disgraceful.
I know it is, and yet we do it every week. Goodbye, everyone.